Welcome to this episode of Eureka, and this episode is a Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award special episode. As we have been doing in the past few weeks, in this episode two, we have a scientist from India who has been awarded with India's most coveted science award, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. And today's guest is Dr. Jyotirmayi Dash from Indian Association for Cultivation of Science, an organization under the Department of Science and Technology in Calcutta. Thank you for being with us in the show. And first, let me, on behalf of myself and also on behalf of the audience of this Raj Sabha TV program, congratulate you for this coveted award. Of course, you have been also awarded with the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship in 2015-16 for your excellent work. And I'm sure this discussion with you today, this conversation with you today is going to be very enlightening and interesting. Thank you for being with us in show, first of all.
Thank you, Dr. Venkat. It's my honor.
Yes, thank you. Broadly speaking, if one looks at your work as the award citation very clearly mentions, the award has been given to you for elegantly applied principles of chemical biology to modulate structures and functions of nucleic acid targets in biological systems, leading to new therapeutic tools for anti-cancer research. That's broadly what the citation, the award citation is mentioning for giving this award to you. And then clearly your website is also talking about two important work that you are carrying it out. One is trying to find using small drug molecules to bind DNA secondary structures to regulate oncogene expression. This is one area. And the second area is developing membrane channels that can deliver small drug molecules to cancer cells. These are two major areas that has been mentioned as broad areas of work that you are doing. So let's start with some of this. Let's start with some elementary ideas, because some of these words are not very familiar to us. So maybe initially we'll try to discuss about some of these words. Let us take understanding and then understand your research. That's what I propose to do in this conversation. So let me ask simple questions. There is a word like oncogene. Some or other, we understand that it is related to cancer. But what exactly is oncogene? Is it a gene which is having mistake? Like generally what we used to believe, or it's something different?
Now, oncogenes are cancer causing genes.
Okay.
So they are present in the human chromosome. They are present in each of our cells. Uh-huh. So they are also key transcription factors. They play key roles in key biological processes like cell growth and many other processes. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, in cancer cells, they overexpress. So for instance, c-myc, let us take one example. This is where we have worked a lot, and we have developed new molecules for targeting and inhibiting the c-myc gene expression.
Yeah.
So this c-myc gene is overexpressed in Burkitt's lymphoma, lung, colon cancer, and others. So many other cancers. So this is actually a transcription factor. This is also responsible for normal cell growth. Mm-hmm. But it just overexpresses. As you know, the gene makes RNA, DNA, mm-hmm. Makes RNA and then proteins.
Yeah.
So that's responsible for us, for our own survival. But the thing is, in these cancer causing genes, c-myc, when it overexpresses, so it makes more proteins. So we have to just inhibit that curing cancers or for the treatment of cancer. And then we can get a new alternative strategy to for anti-cancer research.
See, many of us have this notion. So what you say seems to be slightly different. So that's why I want to elaborate on it and then understand it. That, let's say, for example, if we have sickle cell anemia, it's a disease which is caused because of certain changes in our DNA structure. For example, if you carry that, if both of your alleles are predisposed to sickle cell, then you get sickle cell. So we usually call this as genetic disorders. Some or other people also think that cancer is also a kind of a genetic disorder. But what you are saying is slightly different. It need not be that your genes are wrong, but it is overexpressed.
Sometimes it is overexpressed in many cancers.
So instead of working like a normal way it should work, I mean, it is either working too much or too little.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so if you compare then, for example, the genetic, let's say, sequence of a person in whom the cancer is expressed and a person in whom the cancer is not expressed, you may not find much difference. That's what you're also saying.
Yeah, like, you know, it is like mostly if you see cancers, they are overexpressed. Like in CMYC is overexpressed in 80 to 85% of the cancers.
Okay.
More than 50% cancers are CMYC is overexpressed.
I see.
And another things we are also working on telomerase enzyme. We want to also regulate the telomerase enzyme. So that is also overexpressed in 80 to 85% of cancers. Yeah. Otherwise,
come to that. Maybe some more few words, if we understand, then we would be able to understand your research much deeply. Second is that that statement, for example, trying to selectively bind to DNA secondary structures. That's something that it is talking about. See, the DNA that we have studied in our school is a double helix. It is made up of the genetic alphabets ATGC. This is something that we know. This is a structure, and it's a helix which is like a twisted, let's say, a ladder. That's what we have seen in pictures, and that's what we understand. So, what is this secondary structures?
Yeah. DNA is mostly double helical. When we talk about DNA, means it's just the double helical DNA structure, comes to our mind. Hmm. But DNA can also adopt many secondary structures. For instance, the thing what we are working on, like G-rich, guanine rich, that alphabet G-rich DNA sequences, can adopt folded conformations, which are called G-quadruplex structures. So it is duplex, double helical, this is four-stranded. But this is not four-strand, but this one single strand is folding and giving that G-quadruplex structures. Mm-hmm. So those structures also we can make in the lab. Like we can bring one G-rich sequence and see that it can fold to adopt that secondary DNA secondary structures. Mm-hmm. And we can also add metal ion to stabilize the structures like sodium or potassium. Mm-hmm. And we can also use small molecules to stabilize the structures. Mm-hmm. So we can study this in the lab itself, that the DNA structures can be stabilized, can be folded in the presence of metal ions and small molecules.
Okay. So then why do you prefer, for example, in this small molecules? Why that specific choice of small molecules? Why not any molecule that will work? Is there a specific reason why a small molecule is preferred?
It's not like that. Like if you see, DNA, this is CMYC that I'm telling, DNA quadruplex, this is also a piece of DNA. Mm-hmm. So this DNA is a very early target for developing anti-cancer drugs. Mm-hmm. Even many of chemotherapeutic drugs, anti-cancer drugs, that are used in clinics today, mainly bind to the double helical DNA.
Okay.
But they have many undesired side effects, like they are unable to distinguish between the healthy cells and cancerous cells. Mm-hmm. So we are looking that beyond double helix, so that we can selectively target these structures which are mostly present, or their number is more in the cancer cells, so that they will go and selectively target quadruplex, not duplex DNA. Mm-hmm. So and then you can then significantly do the cancer cell death, or you can inhibit the or switching off the expression of cancer causing genes. So that was the story that we wanted to do this work.
Okay, so you are also pointing out that if this, I mean, when this research become viable, that actually one can develop drugs based on your research, that it will remove many of the problems associated with chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is like
chemotherapy. There are many things, but I am particularly, you know, focusing where the drugs have been used to cure the cancer. What I'm to say in chemotherapy, there are many other approaches, radiotherapy, and I'm not going up about this. I'm only talking about where a small molecular drugs like molecules have been used for chemotherapy.
Okay,
so
okay.
Those have a better option here.
Because by your method, you'll be able to, we will be able to actually address cancer cells and non-cancer cells. We'll be able to make a distinction. That would make the...
Yes.
Yeah. That's I think, a very important and interesting aspect of the research that you have described to us. One part of your research, there is also another area where you are working. Why did you choose this field? I mean, like, why did you choose this way of addressing this issue? Is there any background to it?
Actually, if you look at my background, like, I have been trained as a synthetic organic chemist. I did my PhD in organic chemistry, and I did two postdocs with very excellent mentors and all. They are all in synthetic organic chemistry. Mm-hmm. But then I went to also Cambridge with Professor Shankar Balasubramanian. Okay. So they work in the nucleic acid research, and I was really inspired in these two that to do something to use my knowledge in organic chemistry to apply in these directions. Mm-hmm. So here, what actually we are doing is we are using new chemical tools, mm-hmm. For selectively targeting DNA secondary structures. So here comes my expertise in organic synthesis. Like we are not just making one molecule, or we are just not getting one molecule which are commercially available and studying. But the chemical small molecule library that we are generating ourselves in our lab, and also trying to develop how we can make some new reactions. Like, there's another recent reaction which is called bio-orthogonal chemistry. Mm-hmm. So we are using that chemistry so that we can selectively target these compounds. So what we are trying to do is how classic organic reactions that we have studied, like cycloaddition reaction, diene-salivin reaction, that can be performed in living systems.
Okay.
Or also we can do the reactions to develop new tools to understand biological systems. Mm-hmm. So what exactly we do is we take the DNA targets. Mm-hmm. We know that for us or many of the eukaryotic cells, DNA is the genomic material. But there are also like HIV viruses, they have RNA as the genome. Mm-hmm. So we are also trying to target RNA secondary structures. Okay. DNA so far we have done, but we are also looking beyond DNA, like beyond G quadruplexes and I mutates, like other secondary DNA secondary mm-hmm. structures who have which have a biological role. And also we are looking at the RNA sequences. So what exactly we are doing, we're making molecular fragments. Mm-hmm. So those molecules, if you just leave alone, they won't react with each other.
Okay.
Yeah. But they have reactive functional groups.
Mm-hmm.
So if you use some catalyst, maybe they will work, but they won't work alone if you just leave it. Mm-hmm. So they are quite unreactive. So we're taking those functional groups and using DNA itself.
Mm-hmm.
And leaving it under the physiological conditions that is not in our, under our human body or something. The physiology, we're just taking them and trying to identify that DNA itself selects their own fragments and carry out the transformation. And when the DNA would select its own fragment, then the ligands that would be generated would be highly selective for those DNA targets.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So that was like our goal. Since it's like natural selection process, the system would evolve to generate its specific binder to that particular target. So in that way, like if we can take one fragment library and we can carry out many reactions with the different DNA and RNA sequences, and only the selective compounds would fall. Otherwise, if you combine those, it can also give you like, you know, more, a lot of compounds, a number of products. But these are not going to form in the presence of a DNA. Only those compounds which have the ability to bind to that DNA, particular DNA or RNA structure, then those compounds would form. So we can also say this like chemical genetics approach, because we are trying to develop new molecules that we can also modulate the function of DNA and particular the genes.
You are talking about some of the novel approaches that you are adopting, and one of the novel approach is related to using nanomaterials, nanoparticles, yes. Right?
Yeah.
So what it is actually? I mean, how are you using it? How is it working?
So like what we do is we just prepare gold-coated magnetic nanoparticles. Mm-hmm. So there are plenty of literature reports how to prepare those nanoparticles. Uh-huh. So what we just prepare by using a literature procedure. And then we have immobilized thiolated DNA like quadruplexes and IMOTs on gold-coated magnetic nanoparticles. Mm-hmm. So which were never done or which we have never studied, which were never characterized. So what we have done is we taken CMYC DNA sequences and also other DNA quadruplex forming sequences. Like the quadruplex, another thing I have forgotten to say, like the DNA quadruplex is not only present in CMYC, they are present in many oncogenes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And also in telomeres. So we have taken like two different quadruplex forming sequences, CMYC quadruplex and BCL2 quadruplex. So BCL2 quadruplex is present in the BCL2 oncogene. And we also took their complementary IMOTs. So we wanted to see whether these ligands are selective for quadruplex or IMOTs. Or even we also wanted to identify selective ligands for each of them. Quadruplexes and IMOTs. And we also took control DNAs, like control GDH sequence, single-stranded DNA, and double helical DNA. So we identify, like what we do is we immobilize the gold-coated magnetic nanoparticles on the DNA quadruplexes and IMOTs. Then we have taken a mixture of alkyne and azide fragments. These are small molecule fragments. And we just left it for some time. Actually, we have to leave it for 4 days to identify that really that reaction is taking place. So we analyzed to monitor that whether any product is forming or not. So when we identify that products were forming, then we have, you know, just, this is so simple that we have just did a magnetic decantation. So we just use an external magnet to isolate the DNA. Because DNA is linked to the gold-coated magnetic nanoparticles. So there is magnetic nanoparticles. So when we use the magnet, so only the magnetic nanoparticles will come. So we could isolate our DNA. And along with only those products that are bound to the DNA. And the other products are in the solution. So we just, you know, that is in the supernatant, we just, you know, discard that. And we washed out many times with that DNA and the nanoparticles, DNA nanoparticles, DNA linked nanoparticles, and these newly generated products. And then we again just heat it and put it in buffer and identify the compounds that are bound to the DNA. So it is like we simplify the whole process and we could just have 2 or 3 compounds for each of the DNA target. So we only took those compounds which are quite selective for each of the DNA targets. So we could simplify the process. We did not make all the compounds. We did not screen all these 4 to 6 targets. And so we don't waste like a lot of time in doing chemical synthesis, purifying, and also biophysical screening. So only we took those compounds which bind, and then we do the biophysical screening to know the binding characteristics. And then we took it in the cellular system, like cancer cells, whether they regulate gene expression or whether they're doing overexpression or whether they're doing nothing. So those studies we took over. So in this way, we could simplify the process. And because this process was quite useful because we have used for DNA quadruplexes, IMOTs, and we could also use for RNA, like HIV-1.
Very, very, very nice. Very nice. So let us move to your another area of work where you are trying to, if I read it again, developing membrane channels that can deliver small drug molecules to cancer cells. So let's again understand some of the keywords which are there here. so that then we will be able to understand your research better. Only a new keyword in this, because we have understood the small molecule earlier and we are also knowing cancer cells earlier. The only important keyword is membrane channels.
Right?
We all have read in our school again, for example, the structure of an animal cell. It has a cell wall which defines in and out with regard to that cell. But then some or other, the cells need to also transport material from outside to inside and also from inside to outside. So where does this, that's where the membrane comes in, right? I mean, it all happens through the membrane. So when you say membrane channels, what does it actually mean?
So the cell membrane, as you said, it is made of phospholipid bilayer.
Yeah.
And this lipid bilayer is quite impermeable to ions and to uncharged polar molecules. So what so far, our research that we are dealing with membrane channels for transporting drugs, that is now at preliminary stage. What I would like to say, while we were successful, is transporting metal ions like potassium and sodium. So here I would like to say transmembrane ion channels are large proteins. They are natural proteins. They are present in the phospholipid bilayer. And what they allow actually the transport of ions across the cellular membranes, like going into and coming out of the cells. So, and they are quite selective, right? They really transport a particular type of ions. So in quite interesting, like chemists have been trying to make artificial ion channels.
Okay.
We can say even artificial membrane channels because they are forming channels in the membrane. So they can transport ions and they can be also designed to transport small molecules drugs.
Okay.
So that's what our goal, that many of the drugs, they are cell membrane, they lack cell membrane permeability. They are not permeable well to the cellular membrane. So then they really do not reach to the target. So there, if we can do something like, to make a membrane channel, then they can transport easily. So what we are successful so far, that we have used nucleic acids, as it is one of our area of research, and their components to make transmembrane ion channels that can transport metal ions across the biological membranes. So for this study, we have used only guanosine derivatives before going to DNA quadruplets. So we have to synthetic guanosine derivatives. So they can self-assemble and make channel-like structures. And putting lipophilic chains, so they can be inserted in the membrane and can transport metal ions. So that we have shown in the year 2014. And then again, we use the alpha-based G and C. So G and C also self-assemble with a lipid chain and can also transport metal ions like potassium selectively across the biological membrane. And recently, it was this year that we have shown that DNA quadruplets can also be used to devise transmembrane ion channels.
Okay.
So they can transport ions not only in the bilayer, but even cells in cancer cells, as we have seen, like some of the cells that they can transport ions across the cellular membranes. So this is quite interesting because this can also open up new directions towards nanotechnology, bio-nanotechnology. There are few reports where double helical DNA has been used to create transmembrane ion channels. But as you know, that lipid bilayer, it is the hydrophobic. It's quite difficult to insert a DNA, which is a negatively charged molecule, across the lipid bilayer. We tried, whatever reported, that they are linking porphyrin, is again a small molecule that can bind to the duplex DNA and stabilize the structures. And they have used lipid-like anchors. And it is a covalent linkage. So the DNA, they are linking that and they are designing that. So people have used DNA origami and double helical DNA structures for designing ion channels. So only a very few, I think couple of reports have been there and which are published in very high impact journals like Science and all. So what we thought, like, we are developing molecules and that are binding to the DNA polymerase. So in that case, we are trying to develop molecules which is water soluble and trying the rules of medicinal chemistry that, you know, that can go to the cells and do some cancer causing genes, they can target the cancer causing genes. But here we have to modulate the approach. They should bind but should have a lipophilic chain. So we have designed in that way, like we have designed a molecule that's again nucleic acid derived guanosine derivative with a lipophilic chain. So that molecule binds to the DNA and three molecules of them they bind. We have done some computational studies with in collaboration and all, so that we study that how this molecule is binding to a DNA structure. So and then that when it is bound by the lipophilic structure, so their DNA is completely wrapped by the ligand, and then that assembled structure could be incorporated in the lipid bilayer. And quite interestingly, they could transport iron. And since here the interesting fact is the DNA quadruplets that we have selected, that is only stable in the presence of potassium. So then the structure is stable in the membrane only in the potassium and could transport only potassium ions. So in that way, it was something quite interesting, and it could, you know, just publish this year. And we want to do many more things, like to design more molecules. We're trying to see more ion specific molecules, different ions. So those work is now under progress.
Very, very, very nice. I mean, very interesting range of work. It's very exciting to listen to you, the kind of work that you and your team is doing. Thank you for being with us in this show. I mean, it's a very wonderful conversation. We understood quite a lot, and how in the frontiers of science, people are looking at issues with a fresh perspective in new directions. And thank you for being in the show. And once again, please accept our congratulations for this award. Keep watching, Eureka. We'll come back with another conversation next week, same time.